Well, WA's Premier says he's going to fight like hell to keep his state from ending up like New South Wales. And if that means an iron border into 2022, so be it.
So the Premier, Mark McGowan, joins us now live from Perth. Premier, good morning to you. Great to see you on the program. Gee, haven't you been ruffling some feathers in the east?
Ah, oh, well, such is life.
You're unapologetic.
No, that's right. You know, I've got to do what I've got to do. So we're COVID-free. We don't have any lockdowns whatsoever. We've got a free and open community. We haven't had a case now since late June. And when we did, it came in from Sydney. We locked down and we got rid of it in the course of 4 days. And we have a very, very strong economy and very strong tourism. All our export industries are open. Things are going very well in Western Australia.
Thing is, I mean, you can't stay closed forever, can you? Or can you?
No, that's right. And we've opened at various points in time along this road. And I expect we'll open again once we get to very high levels of vaccination. I expect that would be sometime next year. Once we get to high levels of vaccination, we'll set a date on reopening to the COVID-infected states of New South Wales, Victoria and ACT. That will allow more people to get vaccinated, and when it's safe to do so, we'll open to those states. But I just posed the question to you. Imagine if it was the other way around and Western Australia was the infected place with thousands of cases and New South Wales had none or Victoria had none. Would they really want to open to us? And I think the answer would be no. So we're just doing what is required to keep our people safe.
So two things. What does your vaccination level need to get to, because some are mentioning 90%. There are very few places around the world that have 90%, and some say it's unrealistic. And also, what do the numbers need to be in New South Wales, for example, or Victoria, in order for you to be comfortable with opening up?
Well, vaccination levels, what we've said is between 80% to 90%, and at that point in time we'd set a date, and that may be, you know, 2 months from then. And that would allow everyone who wanted to get vaccinated to get vaccinated. And in the meantime, we've got to get into some of those communities that have low levels of vaccination, Aboriginal communities, multicultural communities, poorer parts of the state, and make sure we vaccinate as many of those people as possible. In terms of the rate in New South Wales, once we get to very, very high levels of vaccination and we give people that opportunity, well, you know, that's not really a relevant consideration, but it's a very relevant consideration now, because obviously if we open a border now, we'll just import COVID into our state, we'll infect our people. For what? Then we'll shut down industries and not be able to provide all the support we're providing to the other states as we are now. Just so you know, we've sent medical teams to New South Wales. We've sent nearly 300,000 masks recently to New South Wales. We've got all our contact tracing teams working on New South Wales from here in Perth. We've offered further doctors and nurses should New South Wales need it.
Do you get what that does to people, though, when you say basically absolutely no way that you're going to be seeing each other for Christmas? And the way you're talking, you won't even look at setting a date until that point. So what, March might be the earliest?
Easter?
Easter?
I can't be precise, but just so you know, I'm one of those people. My mum and dad live in Coffs Harbour, as does my brother, where I went to high school, so I know exactly what it feels like. But the better thing is, I think we all reunite when it's safe to do so. We're used to this. You know, Australia's been going through this now for 19 months or so. Isn't it better if we can remain COVID-free for as long as we can, till we get high levels of vaccination, that we achieve that outcome?
I guess a lot of people in WA and the ones I talk to are awfully worried about the hospital systems over there. We saw last week some major concerns. Are your hospitals ready?
Well, they are, but there's a lot of pressure on our health system, and that's the same in all the states. Particularly, strangely enough, the COVID-free states have more pressure on your emergency departments than the states that have COVID for some strange reason. So it's exactly the same in South Australia and Tasmania. There's a range of reasons behind it, but we have measures ready to put in place should there be an outbreak here, and that's exactly what we did last year in that first big outbreak. You wind down elective surgery, you engage your private hospitals, those sorts of things are the plans we have in place.
Considering the stress the hospital system's already under, are you stressed about how slow the vaccine rollout is in your state?
Well, I think everyone's stressed about that, but I just remind you, we didn't get the million extra doses that above their per capita share that New South Wales got off Pfizer. So other states like ours and South Australia didn't get that extra supply because we're COVID-free. Now, we supported New South Wales and indeed Victoria and Queensland getting extra supply above their per capita share because they had outbreaks, and so vaccinating people more quickly was the right thing to do. But we're going up by about 0.7 of 1% each and every day. As more supply comes on, we'll put in place more measures to get more people vaccinated as quickly as we possibly can. We encourage people every day to get vaccinated, and I just say use AZ, use Pfizer, use whatever you can that you're eligible for to get yourself vaccinated as soon as you can, because that really is the key to us getting out of this and bringing down interstate borders and ending widespread lockdowns and those sorts of things, getting people vaccinated. But we are actually climbing very fast as we speak.
The New South Wales Premier says international travel will be opened up in December for New South Wales. They'll be letting more people in. The Treasurer said last week that people will be able to go to Canada before they can go to Perth. Does that all rile you a little bit?
I'm not that worried about it. I don't understand why people are worried about that. I'm more worried about getting the virus under control in New South Wales, Victoria and the ACT, and also keeping our people safe as to when I could fly to British Columbia. That seems to me to be a secondary consideration. And I think most West Australians agree with that. We'll get back to international travel and we'll get back to travelling to the eastern states. If we can get through this entire period, hopefully unscathed, hopefully, come out of it COVID-free, have high levels of vaccination before we reopen, I think you'll find 95% of West Australians and indeed South Australians, Northern Territorians and Tasmanians would be happy with that. The thing at the moment is there's the sort of states that are COVID positive and there's the non-COVID states. The non-COVID states obviously want to support the states that are COVID positive, but we want to stay as COVID free as we can for as long as we can while we get our vaccination levels up. And we're not really thinking about flying to Canada during that period. Might also add, whilst we remain COVID-free, we support the eastern states with our industries. I mean, 60% of Australia's exports come out of Western Australia. That's about $230 billion worth of exports each and every year. And all the revenue that generates goes to the Commonwealth, which is then able to be sent to New South Wales and Victoria in support packages. So whilst we remain COVID-free in this state, we're providing that massive economic support to the rest of the country, which I think is actually a very good thing.
I just feel like you just don't want us to come back.
Yeah.
You don't love us anymore,
It feels like
Mark.
You're breaking up with us.
Well, I do. As I said, I grew up in New South Wales on the North Coast. And I did. And I love my parents and my family and my brother. And I went to university in Brisbane. So I'm very fond of New South Wales and Queensland, the two places I basically grew up in. But we'll come back, and I'm desperate to go and see them, like everyone else's family over there. It's just a matter of probably waiting a few months.
It looks like you've got a big couple of weeks ahead of you too. You had the Bledisloe yesterday in Perth, you're getting everything. You've got the grand final coming up. That's wonderful for your state, and it's a great endorsement of
your
support.
We're so happy.
AFL. We're really delighted for you.
Well, the Bledisloe, we all knew what would happen there, and it did.
Yeah.
But it was a great event. It was nearly 60,000 people there. And the grand final, that'll be a wonderful event, September 25. I'm not sure who I'm supporting, either Port or Melbourne, one or the other. I hope one of those two wins.
I mean, it's the pick of a bad bunch, isn't it? I mean,
really, it really is. No Lions, no Swannies.
That's it.
It's outrageous. No WA team. Hey, thanks for joining us.
No WA team, but we'll do our best to make it a great event, and 60,000 people be able to attend the event, so it'll be a wonderful occasion.
Yeah, good stuff.
Great to talk to you, Premier. Thank Appreciate you. Your time today over there in WA. 60,000 people.
Thanks for having me.
Crowds. It was, I almost wish it was raining when we were talking. It was a rubbish day. It looked beautiful there as well.
Do you know the only negative for anyone going to the game was that the staff couldn't keep up with the number of beers and pies being sold?
Oh, that's a problem I would love to have.
Same.